It is a real pleasure for us here at the Social and Human Sciences at the University of Iceland and Snarrótin, a grassroots social movement on human rights, to host this seminar talk here today. My name is Helgi Gunnlaugsson, and I'm the chair of the Faculty of Social and Human Sciences, and I will be the moderator of today's talk. Our distinguished guest speaker today, Damon Barrett, I think that's probably the best way to pronounce it, is a co-founder of the International Center on Human Rights and Drug Policy based at the Human Rights Center, University of Essex in the UK, where he is a visiting fellow. He is recognized internationally for his leading work in the areas of human rights and drug control, with a focus on systemic contradictions between these regimes. Human rights and the international institutions of drug control, harm reduction and the right to health, and drug policy and the rights of children. Damon Barrett will give a talk for about 40 to 50 minutes. And then we will have some time for questions, comments, and discussion. And we will have this talk for maybe up to like 6 o'clock. So it will give us ample time both for the talk and for the discussion and comments from you, the audience. Please help me welcome our guest speaker today, Damon Barrett.
Let me just get my distinguished self set up here. Can you hear me okay? Okay, so thanks to Snarrótin and to Peter individually for inviting me to come to Iceland for my first time here. And for choosing, and also sorry to the University of Iceland for giving us this enormous room. I feel even smaller than usual actually standing in here. So. I didn't choose the title of today's talk, but I am very happy with it because I would like to talk about how human rights really has been overshadowed in what we call the war on drugs. The war on drugs being an intentional pejorative. We could call it international drug control, we can call it drug policy. The way human rights has been overshadowed, and maybe the kind of thinking we might want to do to bring human rights more to the forefront or out of the shadows. For quite some time, it's become a refrain, at least in international advocacy circles, that we say we need to adopt a human rights-based approach to drugs. And I often wonder what we mean when we say a human rights-based approach to drugs. It's something I've said for a long time. But I don't think it's been elaborated fully. And the problem with not fully elaborating what it is that it could mean anything to anybody. It could be a human rights-based approach just said as a part of rhetoric could support anybody from the most free market of capitalists to the most restrictive of prohibitionists. So what do we mean when we talk about a human rights-based approach? Let me give an example of that problem of elaboration. I used to work, and I still do, in a field called harm reduction. For those that aren't aware of that, harm reduction is an area of drug policy where we aim to reduce the health and social harms associated with drug use without necessarily requiring that people stop using drugs. That doesn't mean that reductions in use and cessation of use are not positive, but it's not a necessary quality of harm reduction. Now, the definition and principles of harm reduction I won't go into, but they are very jealously defended, because otherwise, reducing harm could be anything to anybody. Let me give you an example of that. Not long ago, the International Narcotics Control Board, that's a UN entity that visited here in March last year. I'm going to talk about it a bit later on, but that body oversees the implementation of three international treaties that form the legal, international legal framework for prohibition of drugs. And they said that these treaties are at their core about harm reduction because they aim to reduce harm. But let me tell you, these treaties are not at all, by any stretch of the imagination or definition, about harm reduction. Because harm reduction is not two words strung together. It's a concept and a philosophy represented by those words. By the same token, human rights-based approach to drug policy can't just be those words used to defend any predetermined position except human rights. So, what is the concept that is represented by a human rights-based approach to drug policy? Now, I want to begin with a bit of context. We need to talk a little bit about the human rights situation that we're talking about. Now, I'm not interested in showing you gory pictures of murders and people hanged for drug offenses and shot for drug offenses and wound abscesses and people living on the streets. I don't want to do it, but if you want to Google it, knock yourself out. Instead, I'm going to tell some of this by way of protests in five different countries with five very different situations. And the reason I'm doing this is because I think drug control is becoming a story of resistance against what's increasingly understood as being overbroad and arbitrary state control. On the top left is a picture from Mexico. If anyone's unaware of the situation in Mexico, please do look it up, but do avoid the image search on Google. It's horrific. Over 100,000 deaths now in drug-related violence since 2006. Tens of thousands of children have lost one or both parents in that violence. And this protest is about ongoing now social protests against the militarization of the drug war in that country and a broad campaign for peace. It's not just about drugs, but drugs is a huge part of it. On the top right is a protest that took place at the International Harm Reduction Conference in 2009. And the person speaking there is a representative of the Thai Drug Users Network. And what they're protesting against is cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment in drug treatment centers in the country. I don't know if anyone's aware of the situation in this region, but there is a phenomenon that was a human rights and an ongoing human rights scandal that was really overlooked, which is drug detention centers. And if we include China, there are maybe 500,000 people, predominantly in Southeast Asia, locked up in these centers because they are drug users or suspected of using drugs. There's no due process, medical or legal, and once inside, the abuses inflicted upon people have been documented by Human Rights Watch in Laos, in Cambodia, in China, and Vietnam. Thailand also has almost no harm reduction programs. The state will not implement them, despite the fact that the primary route of transmission for HIV in the country is the absence of harm reduction services. I won't even say unsafe injecting because I blame this on the state. Thailand's also a death penalty state, one among 33 countries in the world that retain the death penalty for drug offenses on the books. Another one is India, which is just beneath. The protest here from June 26th, you'll see the placard say, the green one, "Support, don't punish." That's a global campaign at the moment. India has the mandatory death penalty for drug offenses on the books for certain repeat offenses. Recently, the Bombay High Court struck this down and said we need judicial discretion. The government is now appealing that to the higher courts in the country. India has massive drug use problems, as you could imagine, given the scale of its population, but the government's not doing nearly enough about it. It also has some of those detention centres that I talked about. To the left, we have a protest in London against the Russian government's drug policies, which are a cautionary tale for the entire world about what not to do when faced with drug problems. The Russian government refuses to implement harm reduction programs. Methadone is a medicine that is the World Health Organization gold standard for the treatment of opiate dependence. It's illegal in Russia. There are tens of thousands of overdose deaths. There are unknown numbers of people in prison for non-violent drug offenses. In Europe, 1 in 4 women in prison are there for non-violent drug offenses in Europe and Central Asia. Russia imprisons more women for drugs than the entire European Union combined. And while we're on the subject of incarceration, just beneath that is a protest from the International Drug Policy Reform Conference run by the Drug Policy Alliance. Did anybody come to see Ethan Nadelman's talk? Right, so his organization runs this conference that this protest took place at. The US, for its incarceration rates, imprisons more people for drugs than the European Union has imprisoned for all offenses combined, and we have more people than the United States of America. Black and Latino men are disproportionately represented. There are other issues, of course, in the US, from police violence to some states denying harm reduction services. There are also some positives. But an interesting thing about the US is the way that it's used drug control as a means of controlling or geopolitical control against other states. Which leads me to another protest I couldn't fit into that last slide, and the aerial fumigation of coca and opium in Colombia. Now, Colombia is the only country in the world where this is carried out. It's rejected in Afghanistan because everyone knows it would be a horrible idea. It has been going on for 30 years in Colombia. They were spraying paraquat in Colombia 10 years after it was internationally banned, which is ironic to use a banned chemical to spray a banned plant. But it's sprayed on the second most biodiverse region in the world, and it's contributing to internal human displacement that now outstrips Darfur. It's contributing to the civil conflict that has raged for decades. The FARC consider ending fumigation a prerequisite for peace, and it goes on and on. It's causing groundwater problems, it's causing pregnancy problems, skin rashes, and other health concerns, food insecurity problems. And it still carries on. In other parts of the world and in Colombia, we use manual eradication. It's a slightly lesser evil. Let me put it this way. If you go into a rural community where their way of life is growing a certain crop and you send a bunch of men with scythes to rip up their livelihood, you're asking for a fight. And what's been documented in Colombia is these people being sent out, houses burned to the ground, crops ripped up, property stolen, fights, women raped. There is no state presence in many of these places, and some of these people experience only the spraying, only the crop eradication. As a friend of mine from the Institute for Policy Studies, San Jotri, said, they get all stick and no carrot. So I wanted to come back to the US for a second to show you how scandalous it is. The graph on the top left there is incarceration rates since 1972. We blame Richard Nixon a lot, but look what happened around the time Reagan got in. Look what kept going when Bush Sr. was in. Look what kept going when Clinton came in. Look what kept going. There have been some slight changes to this now. But the bottom left picture is an overcrowded prison from California a few years ago, just before the Supreme Court ordered some of those people had to be released. The conditions were too poor. Now, I don't want to stick too much with the US. I'm representing prison overcrowding here. In Indonesia, people are in cells that are cramped with 20 people when they're fit for four, many in there for drug offenses. And of course, the racism of the drug war in the United States is well known. But it's not just prisons, because I know what I've talked about already might be a bit distant from the situation in Iceland, right? But let's look instead at people being stopped, searched, frisked for drugs and criminal records. This is a graph, a very simple graph from a very, very detailed report by one of my favorite NGOs called Release in the United Kingdom. And they looked into stop and search for drugs in the United Kingdom. Someone is stopped and searched every minute for drugs in the UK. And this is a country with a reputation for more of a health and harm reduction approach. 70,000 criminal records for possession were handed down last year in the UK, 1.2 million since 1996. We take criminal records for granted as if they're not a serious thing to do. A criminal record is not to be sniffed at. This is something that is intentionally inflicted harm. Just the same way as putting somebody in prison is. It's intended to harm you, either for a few years if it's later expunged, or for the rest of your life. It's intended to hurt you. So I think criminal records need to be taken very, very seriously if they're to be handed down. And just again to look at something a little bit closer to home, the way we deal with drugs in our schools. When did it become acceptable to run sniffer dogs through our children's schools, to search our children's school bags, and to in this case of Savannah Redding in the US and many other kids, to strip search them? When did it become acceptable to randomly test our kids for drugs as if we don't trust them? On the left is a thing I wrote, weirdly, for a very right-wing newspaper called the Daily Mail, where there was talk of sniffer dogs and testing in schools, and I wanted to respond to why it would be an awful idea. On the bottom right, though, is a story from 2012 from Södermalm in Stockholm. And I live in Gothenburg in Sweden. And in this case, what happened was, early in the morning, a bunch of seventh to ninth grade young kids, police came to their homes and got them out of bed and were searching for drugs. They found none. No drugs, nobody was charged. And the police still claimed it was a successful operation because it sent a message that future commission of crime would not be a good idea. Now, who gets held accountable for that kind of behavior? And that's one of my first questions, I guess, this idea of accountability. So it leads me to what I'm really getting to. All of those things can be too easily dismissed as the action of one government, one wayward police officer, one state agency, even one country. And obviously, we need to undo all of those things. Obviously, fumigation in Colombia has to stop. The solution to some of those problems is obvious in contradistinction to what it is. We shouldn't be killing people, locking people up arbitrarily. Those things need to stop immediately. But does it fix the system? Does it fix what's wrong and what led to that stuff being done? And this really, I think, is about where my human rights argumentation comes in. My argument is that these problems are not just systematic, which they are, and widespread, which they are. I'm saying they're systemic, which requires systemic change. And that's kind of a serious claim. But I have three primary arguments that I have up here on the slide that I'm going to talk about for the remainder of my time. One is that the system is built on a narrative or a framing of existential threat, a very, very strong story of threat, and that's been imposed for many decades. The second, and this is, I'm focusing on the international system, right? And I'm going to explain a little bit about what it is. I'll do it now. Almost every government in the world has signed up to and agreed to be bound by those three treaties I referred to earlier. One from 1961, one from 1971, and one from 1988. Iceland's party to all three. Overseeing that are some institutions in the UN. And the World Health Organization has an important role that's increasingly marginalized by those other institutions. So this is what I'm going to focus on. And I'm going to say that what states, aside from the existential threat, what states are required to do by international law is very risky from a human rights perspective, like all law enforcement is risky from a human rights perspective. In one or two cases, I would argue that what was agreed in 1961 is no longer legal in human rights terms. But instead of being accountable for the risk and the inherent risk, the way success is measured in drug control hides it and masks it and doesn't bring it out into the light. It keeps it in the shadows. And finally, I'm going to argue that the institutions or the governance of drug control internationally has deficits of transparency, accountability, and civil society participation. In other words, I'm going to argue it's got a democratic deficit. And all of these things are a recipe for abuse being more likely and less likely to be addressed. So let me begin then with the existential threat. This is a diagram I've made, but the five numbered, I trust they're still numbered, slides are from a report from 2008. And the report was done by the UN Office on Drugs and Crime. That is a part of the United Nations Secretariat that Ban Ki-moon is the head of, right? Now, it's the one responsible, obvious from its name, for drugs and crime. So in 2008, ironically, in a report that actually said the system was somewhat working, these five were identified as the big picture, quote, unintended negative consequences of the international drug control system. The first one is that the system created a criminal market of macroeconomic proportions, and that brought with it all sorts of violence, corruption, and security destabilization. The second was what they called policy displacement, and what they meant was more policy space and more money and more effort being piled into enforcement instead of health, which was the original justification, at least ostensibly, for the system. Third was what they called geographic displacement. Has anybody heard of the balloon effect? If you imagine trying to eradicate production of a plant like opium, poppy, like this. You can eradicate it in one place, but because the demand for it stays high somewhere else, it will grow somewhere else. So it's like having a semi-inflated balloon that you keep pressing, but bits pop up. Another effect of the geographic displacement is if you interrupt or interfere with a trafficking route, a new route will emerge. It moves, it doesn't really end. The fourth was what was called substance displacement, and this really related to new patterns of drug use emerging as the market was interfered with. So have people heard of novel psychoactive substances, things like methadone or spice and so on? And finally, another identified harm was the marginalization or the pushing to the margins of society people who use drugs, and I think more accurately, people with drug problems who were the original intended beneficiaries of the system. Now, in my view, the entire charade of the system is torn asunder with this critique, but that's not the way the report went. In any case, I wanted to show, and I will come back to it, how the existential threat really drives and reinforces and keeps this cycle going. So here's the threat that I'm talking about. You've heard, surely, government saying that drugs are a threat to children, that drugs are a scourge. That's a favorite word. It's as if it's being very clever to say so. Drugs are a scourge or a societal disease and so on. Well, it's not just empty political posturing. That language is what begins those treaties that all of our governments have signed up to be part of. The 61 Single Convention is the one I mentioned. It says that addiction is an evil that the international community has a duty to combat. A friend of mine, Rick Lines, has done his PhD in human rights and drugs, and as a very small part of it, he just wanted to check where else in international law that word evil comes up. Do you think it came up in the Genocide Convention? No. It's not in the Torture Convention either. But it does come up here in the context of drugs. And I wouldn't say it's even that, you know, it's not like it's old language. The Genocide Convention's older than this, you know. That was intentionally put in there. Now, by the time the Trafficking Convention came up, we were now talking about a threat to look at this, the economic, cultural, and political foundations of society. A danger of incalculable gravity. That is really strong rhetoric. And undermining the legitimate economies of states. Now, here's the question. If you ramp up a threat of that scale, what does the public expect of you to do about it? You can't say, well, yeah, it's a threat to our way of living, but we're not really going to do much about it, right? Now, so we have the existential threat, and because of that, we have to do something about it. We create the criminal market and it comes into being, okay? Now, the problem with the creation of the criminal market, as mentioned, and the corruption and violence it brings, is that the threat is all the more obvious and manifest. So, what do? Well, you throw more effort at it, and you fight the drug trade itself. So you throw more money into enforcement rather than health. Point two, in doing so, you continue to interrupt production and transit, and you move the problem to different parts of the world, and what happens then? Well, new communities experience the threat, and they want their governments to do something about it too. And the fact that the problem is moving around ramps it up further. You do this, you interrupt markets sometimes, and new drugs emerge on the scene or new patterns of use. And that's a new threat. And that's added. Now we have to do something about novel psychoactive substances. Now we have to ban spice. Now we have to ban all of these other things. Now we have to put police out on the streets enforcing synthetic cannabinoids, and so on. And all the while, you have managed to create what Niels Christie would have called the convenient enemy. You have created a population that are to blame, whether it's people who use drugs in this case, people growing them, or moving them around. This is the enemy that you fight. And these are the people that we can, in particular, in relation to people with very, very problematic or chaotic drug use, we can look down our noses upon them. And they are part of the threat, and we throw law enforcement at them as well. Now, that is what we call, surely, a positive feedback loop. That reinforces itself. And I would argue that this is very difficult to break, but I would argue that, at least in the immediate sense, there are two things to be done. And the first is to change the way we talk about drugs. Because you take out the existential threat, and maybe we can free ourselves from this ridiculous cycle. The other, because there, look at the five harms, right? Numbers 1, 3, 4, and 5 are long-term change now. Those are things that are going to be difficult to deal with, but we can massively and transformatively reinvest in health and away from enforcement. That's within the purview of your government right now to do. It's within the purview of the Swedish government where I live, the Irish government where I'm from, or the British government where I spent most of my career. Those are two routes, but begin with changing, I think, the way we talk about drugs. And that's part of a human rights-based approach. It requires us not just to look at the problems, right? an analogy is gender-based violence. You don't just look at one guy who has murdered or severely beaten a woman. You look at societal misogyny, and you look at discrimination within the society for what's driving it. So while we have to deal with those many abuses I mentioned, there is something systemic that also needs to be addressed. Just my one very difficult beginning practical suggestion. This is a grotesque map of the world. I mentioned displacement from health to law enforcement. There are two aims of the international drug control system. What should be the main aim is getting medicines to people who need them. Morphine, for example, for pain, is controlled in the same way, pretty much, that heroin is for recreational use, in the same system. A system built on eliminating demand is supposed to ensure access and availability for almost the same stuff. Now, the system doesn't work. The attention is hugely towards stopping people using drugs for recreational use, and not at all enough towards getting the same controlled medicines to people who need them. So this map is corrected for access to opiates for pain relief. And you'll see that we can barely see Africa. We can barely see Southeast Asia or Latin America. We can barely see the developing world, whereas the United States and Canada is very, very fat. This is a global public health and medical scandal, and I would suggest needs to be the focus of the next number of decades' drug control priorities. I wanted to bring that to your attention because a lot of us didn't realize that that was such an enormous problem. That's my first argument, that the narrative of existential threat is driving this thing. It's driving a system that is reinforcing itself. Now, I talked about a positive feedback loop, and this relates to my second argument. What states are required to do under this system is to... The treaties are hugely focused on the supply reduction side rather than treatment and prevention and so on. Very focused on a theory that if you can knock out supply, you can deal with use. Or if you can interfere with the market enough, you can drive prices up and people won't buy them because they're too expensive. In order to achieve that, the indicators are that you arrest people, you prosecute people, you extradite people between countries, you seize kilos of drugs, you eradicate hectares of crops. You count how many people use drugs as well. But let's start with those main indicators. You know, you see the police or a politician on the news, and they have a table full of drugs. And they say, look, we've had a major seizure here, a major, major win. I talked to a former senior police officer with the Metropolitan Police in London. And he said, you know, one of those stories, what looks like a big one, do you know what that does to the drug market in London? I said, no. He goes, it interrupts it in a local area for about 3 days. Right, now, that's one thing. Interdiction doesn't really do much. Fractions of the drugs going around the world. The UN has a container control program. You know how many containers go across the oceans in a day? This is needle in a haystack stuff, really. Now, the other thing though, what do these indicators tell you about outcomes? Does arresting somebody tell you anything about a health outcome, which is supposed to be the aim of the system? I would argue that all these indicators do is tell you what the state's doing, and nothing at all about the health goal that was supposed to underpin why they're doing it. But at the same time as not telling you anything positive about health or social care or anything, they are indicators of human rights risk. Because if you arrest somebody, I want to know how you arrested them. I want to know how you surveilled them, and so on. If you put somebody on trial, I want to know how fair it's going to be. If you extradite somebody, I want to know if they're going to be tortured or killed. If you wipe out somebody's way of livelihood, by ripping up their crops. I want to know how they're going to survive. The family, I mentioned Colombia. Those people growing those crops are poor. This is not a money spinner. This is month by month subsistence farming. This is survival work. They don't make any money out of it. What are they going to do? And so on and so forth. Now, if all we do is measure the arrests and measure the prosecutions and measure the extraditions and all of that stuff, we're not getting to the heart of what should be achieved, and we're masking and camouflaging the human rights costs of doing all of that. So that's another one of my systemic concerns. You cannot go on chasing your tail on something that seems to be very ineffective and not be honest and accountable for the human rights risks and the human rights actual harms of doing it. So two questions then for me. What does a human rights-based approach ask about the aims of drug control? Not just how it goes about it, but what it set out to do. What is the human rights basis or justification upon which governments see fit to do all of this stuff? And then, after we establish the aims, what are the standards and the boundaries on state action in that regard? These are two important questions that sound maybe a little bit flaky, but I think they have very, very practical outcomes. I'll give an example at the very end of what one of those might be. Now, here's the thing. They might be somewhat simple questions to us. That's actually a very controversial thing to ask at the United Nations in the drug control institutions. Because not only is the narrative of threat that I talked about embedded in the system, so is the disproportionate focus on enforcement. It's all part and parcel of the system and the treaties. So, it leads me to my third argument, which is the democratic deficit in the international drug control system. This is a picture of the UN Commission on Narcotic Drugs. Actually, on the bottom left is my friend, Rick Lyons, who I mentioned earlier on. The person in the very bottom corner on the left. That's where they put civil society speakers. Over to the left is the door to the toilets, in fact. to be fair, civil society participation has gotten a little bit better in this commission because civil society have fought and fought and fought to shine some light on what goes on here, what our governments say on our behalf at this commission. Because really, unless you're there, they don't report on what they say. You will find a report, but it's very, very top line. It's very hard to find out what governments do. What we did a few years ago is we started going, and this was a bit before Twitter, we started blogging verbatim what people were saying. We had volunteers doing it, which we thought was helpful. And now it's easier, we just tweet what they're saying. The Commission on Narcotic Drugs, despite all of those abuses, I've said, has never, as an institution, called out any one state for what it's doing. Never. There was once in its history a human rights resolution that was agreed, and I helped with the negotiations. I was on the UK delegation. It was a really bland thing, just calling for a bit more of a focus on human rights. This commission could only agree to it after any mention of the death penalty, any mention of indigenous people's rights, and any mention of the other parts of the UN that deal with human rights were stripped out of the text, and then they could agree it. Now, that shows how low the bar is on human rights at this particular commission. Now, the other problem we have here is that the treaties that this commission is basing its policies around are not only problematic in their terms, they were problematic in their development. They're regionally, culturally, and racially biased in the substances they control and in the focus of the efforts in developing countries. And that is still the legal framework for the actions undertaken. That's not talked about either. We could, The other thing about those treaties, of course, and I mentioned, is U.S. use of them in terms of control. But this is a commission that is, in its functioning, focused with massive effort on maintaining consensus, maintaining the appearance that everything's okay, that governments agree on what to do about drugs, and we sit there and they don't vote on anything. It's all agreed by consensus. So it looks like all governments are on side. But that leads me to that question of voting. There is one thing they vote on, whether or not to bring another drug into the control system. One of those votes is going to happen in March on a drug called ketamine. Ketamine, you might have heard of as a drug in the club scene, for example, or in parties. China has brought forward this proposal, and this body called the International Narcotics Control Board wants to see it controlled as well. The problem, remembering that map of the world and the medicines thing, ketamine is the only or one of the only anesthetics available for surgeries in rural parts of the developing world now. The World Health Organization has recommended 3 times that it not be brought under control, and it's still up for a vote, but there's only 53 members of the commission, and only 36 of them have to agree for it to be brought under control, and most of the developing countries that are affected are not there. That's a major democratic deficit. Iceland's not a member, you guys don't get a say. It does have rotating membership, but right now you're not a member. So that's the Commission on Narcotic Drugs. It's not a place where systemic problems are going to be talked about and raised. It's just not going to happen like that. So then we lead, this is the body I said I would come back to. If anybody studies human rights law, you will know that if you have a human rights treaty, like the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, you have what's called a treaty body, an independent monitoring mechanism, and that's what the International Narcotics Control Board is. The difference is the human rights ones webcast their meetings, allow civil society to go and talk to them, to talk about their governments. They allow written submissions to be taken into account, shadow reports from what their government says, so that it's not all congratulatory of the government, and so on. This body conducts almost all of its meetings behind closed doors. Even governments aren't allowed to go. Now, I was trying to come up with an analogy for what that's like, and it's something like this. Imagine you have 2 people, say one lives in Sweden and one in Iceland, and they both own adjoining properties in Denmark, and they want to build a wall between them. Well, the INCB, as it's called, is like the contractor that they would get to make sure the work is done, but the contractor won't let either owner know what's happening. It's pretty much what the International Narcotics Control Board does. It's almost entirely lacking in any form of transparency, any form of accountability for its deliberations, right, and any form of civil society participation that is contrary to all of the standards and working methods that have developed in the UN system that it's a part of. It took us 8 years to convince this body to say that governments shouldn't execute people for drugs. That took 8 years, and even then it was said in a very weak way. Let me show you something. This is a picture on the top from the day that the Canadian Constitution, or the Supreme Court of Canada, handed down a decision saying that the government could not shut down the safe injection facility in Vancouver. The bottom is a picture of that facility when it's empty. The international, do you know what safe injection facilities are? This is where somebody can go under health and social care supervision and inject drugs. And for this place, for example, had 1 million injections had taken place since it opened. Not one overdose death, not one. And the International Narcotics Control Board said that it should be closed down because it's a violation of international law. I just, trust me, it's not. It is not a violation of international law to open a safe injection facility. The thing is, the International Narcotics Control Board never, ever set out its legal reasoning for that. Never engaged with the evidence around it. This was an ideological bias affecting the legal reasoning of a quasi-judicial United Nations monitoring mechanism. That is a serious, serious problem. Show you another example. The INCB, as it's called, congratulates the most repressive governments while criticizing those, such as Canada, that do something a little bit more progressive or a little bit at the fringes of the enforcement or prohibitionist regime. Here we see the board congratulating Mexico, and you remember what I said about what went on there. Here it was about the decisive measures to counter the drug-related problems. Well, the decisive measures resulted in a 1,000% increase in complaints to the human rights commissions in the country and the escalation of violence. Here, we see the board asking Vietnam to reinforce, it says, and support, this is important, existing facilities. You remember I mentioned drug detention centers. Well, that's what Vietnam has. And that's what the INCB said they should reinforce. And that's a picture of one. That man on the right is the former United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health from India, Anand Grover. And he had just called for those same centers after his mission to Vietnam to be closed down as a rights violation. And now we have the United Nations disagreeing with itself. In fact, now every United Nations agency, UNAIDS, UN Office on Drugs and Crime, in fact, World Health Organization, UN Women, all have called for these centers to be shut down, except these guys. Now, this leads me to the civil service. The International Civil Service is the UN Secretariat, and I'm still in Vietnam here. The UN Office on Drugs and Crime has been helping to set up border liaison posts on the border of China, Vietnam, Laos, and other countries, as well as Iran. Well, it's actually the borders of Afghanistan, but Afghanistan happens to border Iran and Pakistan for many, many years, with funding from lots of different countries. Can you see where I'm going with this? Most of the countries in this map are death penalty states. We don't know how many people China executes. It's a state secret. It seems to be going down over time after some recent judicial changes, but it's a lot still. In 2013, last year, no, 2 years ago, Vietnam sentenced 30 people to death in one day for drug offenses. We have been pushing the UN Office on Drugs and Crime to stop assisting death penalty states to catch traffickers on the basis that they are helping catch people who may well be killed. And we have documented named individuals that have been captured with European money, filtered through the United Nations, who were then extradited to China and executed to celebrate the United Nations Day Against Drugs, which is June 26th, when one of those protests, I said, took place. The situation in Iran is probably the worst. Iran executed between 600 and 700 people last year, most of them for drug offenses, some of them in secret, some of them in public. The UNODC refuses to withdraw its support for drug enforcement in that country as well. Now, I have to say, the UNODC is a very broad organization. It does some very good work too. But this is a serious problem of accountability. And here again, I come back to human rights-based approaches. Human rights is not just a bunch of things we say not to do. It's also a bunch of principles and standards about governance. Transparency and accountability are two of the most important. Where is the accountability for this? The UNODC, after much pressure, adopted internal human rights guidance and won't even follow that. And the reason, I think, is money. The UNODC has no independence because it's almost entirely dependent on earmarked money from donors. So it will do what the money tells it to do. It's as simple as that. And I would say that much like we say that to deal with police corruption, better standards for police and better pay for police is one way to go, I would say unearmarked funding for a civil service like this is not such a bad idea. Or for donors to give the UNODC money to do something a little bit more positive. Denmark, I should point out, ceased its funding to this program. So did Ireland, I'm proud to say. The United Kingdom did as well. I don't think there's any donors left for the Iran program drug enforcement element, but there are still donors contributing to something called the Triangular Initiative, which is focused on Afghanistan. But the other two countries in the triangle are Iran and Pakistan. And one of those donors is Norway. And Norway thinks it's got no money going to Iran, but it does. So there we have another issue of accountability for human rights. Now, this is my final slide I'm going to get to in a sec. What do I mean by a human rights-based approach to drug policy? I know that all of that seems quite distant to Iceland, and I don't really know the situation in this country, so I'm not going to claim to talk about it. I do know that every country in the world is complicit in all of this, because we've all signed up to the same system that I've argued keeps it going, and that it's become an obligation, if we take human rights seriously, to start talking about it in some kind of an open way, freed up from this pathological concern with consensus about how we deal with drugs. I think that drugs is the wrong place to begin your conversation. Here's what happened in the international system. What's the scientific method? You take a hypothesis and you try and disprove it, right? What we did here was we took a hypothesis that I mentioned earlier about supply and fiddling with the market, and we made it legally binding. And then every country in the world made it legally binding themselves too. And even though it's been disproven comprehensively, we're stuck with the damn thing. That's something that has to change. What if we began somewhere different? Instead of institutionalizing that kind of relatively arbitrary assumption and all of the certainty that comes with it, what about a healthy dose of doubt? What if we say, I don't know, but I do know that I want to base it on these principles that I don't want to back off from. I'm not willing to back off on non-discrimination, and I'm not willing to back off on government action without any form of accountability for what it does, for what it says it was going to do. What if we began looking at it from human rights principles? We begin with our objectives, our social and health objectives at the end. That's what we want to achieve. But at the beginning, we set up the principles that are going to guide what we do, and we see what comes out the other end of it. And I'll tell you this, if you do that, at the very least, the criminalization of personal possession for drugs doesn't survive at all. And I'll tell you why. If we take the right to privacy seriously, and I think Iceland does, it's in your constitution, it's in the constitutions of many countries, then we have standard tests, don't we, for when it's legitimate to infringe upon that. Does the infringement serve a legitimate aim? Well, I used to say that the drug control system would pass that test. I think we could revisit it and ask what its aims were. But if it's health, I'll accept it. If it's protecting children, we can accept it. Now, is there no less restrictive means available to achieve that aim? Well, when was another option ever on the table here? When did we ever set five options alongside each other and see which passed our tests? No, we got handed this. And we never ran it through this test. And when it does, there's a conflict. And human rights is always the thing that gives way, not drug control. Why? I think it's back to that existential threat thing. That's a good example. I don't think criminalization of personal possession passes. I don't think sniffer dogs in schools pass. I don't think denying people harm reduction services passes. In fact, that latter thing, I think, becomes one of the major focuses of what we do. I don't think disproportionate spending, because budget analysis is a part of this too. If we believe that economic, social, and cultural rights should be maximized to the maximum of our available resources, then I think budget analysis is a part of this too. And I don't think the disproportionate spending on enforcement survives either. And I don't think some of those grotesque abuses that states have thrown at people survive. But where do you start with something like this, you see? I was really inspired by a guy called Professor Paul Hunt. He used to be the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health. And I saw him teach a few weeks ago in Essex, where my center's based. And he was talking about some work that they're doing on applying a human rights-based approach to emergency care in Northern Ireland. And I thought it was really inspiring, because it's something you think, well, emergency care is fine, it works well. But they said, yeah, but it could be a bit better. You know, what if we put patient dignity at the start and we look at working conditions and we really explicitly base it on the principles that matter to us and see what happens there? And I was really inspired by taking that idea. So what if we did something simple on a local level in a country like this? Pilot something. Like in our schools, what if we said, you know, we just need one school manager, one school district to say, we'll take it on board. What if we began with children's rights and we'll approach drugs from the perspective of their rights first and see what our school-based interventions then look like? I think that would be an interesting thing to do. And it might yield, I don't know, but like I said, I think the I don't know is healthy, but it might be really positive. Now, I'm going to finish with this. It's a bit more lighthearted, but I mainly put it up because I just love the cartoon. And I love the artist. It's Chris Riddle. He's a political cartoonist and children's illustrator. And this was from a children's book that I got for Father's Day a few years ago. And it's cartoons depicting the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And this is Article 28, which states that everyone is entitled to an international and social order in which the rights and freedoms in this declaration can be guaranteed. The dragon is the war on drugs. The crumbled streets and the buildings and the broken lamps are human rights, as far as I'm concerned. And I even love the little innocent face the dragon has. Oops. As if you couldn't see it coming. As if letting a Godzilla-sized thing walk through your streets wasn't going to crush these things. And I guess following the metaphor through, what I'm suggesting is, what if you take the dragon out of the picture and you rebuild the streets, right? And you come back in with a new character that's able to navigate the streets without breaking anything and maybe make them a little bit safer on its way. So I'll be here for a while and I'm happy to take questions. Thanks.